So I'd like to welcome everyone at this very special event today, the official online book launch of Máté Szalai's very new book, which has the title of The Foreign Policy of Smaller Gulf States, Size, Power, and Regime Stability in the Middle East. Today's event is organized jointly by the Institute of Foreign Affairs and Trade and the Department of International Studies at Corvinus University of Budapest, and it is organized in cooperation with Routledge Publishing. I won't waste too much time with the introduction, so let me introduce the speakers of today's panel. First of all, of course, we have here Máté Szalai, Senior Research Fellow at the Institute for Foreign Affairs and Trade and Senior Lecturer at Corvinus. Welcome, and I hope that we will have a very lovely discussion about your book today. Then we have here Luciano Zaccara, Assistant Professor and Research Coordinator at the Gulf Studies Center at the Qatar University. Welcome you as well. And last but not least, Laszlo Csicsman, Associate Professor at the Corvinus University of Budapest. And I myself, I am Nicolette Garai, Research Fellow at the Institute for Foreign Affairs and Trade. And we've been doing research on small state studies with Máté since a couple of years. So I'm really happy that I can moderate this event. Just a few technical details. If you have questions to the panelists, you can type that in the chat box. You can type it anytime, and I will ask those questions from our panelists. So don't be shy. We hope that you will ask a lot of questions. Okay, so without further ado, let's start with a short introduction of the book. So Máté, can you tell us a few words about your book? Why did you write it? And what do you think, what was the most important idea on which your book was based?
Thank you, and thanks for everybody who is here and who contributes to this discussion. I'm very happy that I can share and we can share a couple of ideas regarding the topic and the book itself. Let me start by reflecting on the research behind the book. Basically, this is the outcome of my PhD research, which took 6 years to finalize. I started to work on small states and the Persian Gulf region in 2013 under the supervision of Professor Csicsman for my master's thesis. And back at that time, I applied small state theory on the case of Qatari foreign policy. So that was my gateway to this topic. And back then, I felt that our understanding of how smallness and state size affects foreign policy in general in the IR literature is very superficial and very general. And usually we consider small state size as an essential weakness, which creates security deficiencies and other kind of deficiencies. And some small states try to circumvent these deficiencies in different ways, and some manage, but basically that's all that we discuss, not just in mainstream IR, but in the framework of small state studies as well. So I wanted to take a step back and reflect on how state size actually affects state behavior, and how smallness contributes to specific foreign policy outcomes. And I think that this research question, so how can we capture the way in which smallness and state size in general affects foreign policy, to answer this research question, Gulf states are great case studies, mostly for two reasons. First of all, despite their systematically alike situation, we can see a variety of state behavior and strategy. For example, if we compare the case of Bahrain and Oman, one pursues a foreign policy of a passive strategy, I would say, and another tries to be active, but it tries to remain on the side and behind the curtains, which is a very interesting foreign policy in general. So this is the first reason why the Gulf states are great case studies. The second reason is that even in individual cases, we can see specific changes in foreign policy. Think about the foreign policy of Qatar, for example, which in which we can see very interesting change of foreign policy strategy in the 1990s. And in this case, we can track the effect of different independent variables and causes, including domestic politics, including changes in the regional system, the Saudi-Iranian rivalry, and so on. So I think that these countries, why usually we group them together, they are very good case studies in comparing the ways in which smallness can affect foreign policy behavior. So my answer to this question was the question about how state size affects foreign policy was the creation of a very simple model in the book. This is what I call the complex model of size. And this model rests upon 3 + 1 observations. 3 observations which talk about how smallness should be seen in international relations and an additional observation regarding how it affects state behavior. So the 3 observations regarding how smallness affects foreign policy are the following. The first is that when we talk about state size, we usually talk about very different concepts. And in the literature, we can find 4 different kinds of size. I don't want to go into details, but that's what the book is for. But basically, we confuse absolute size, relative size, perceptual size, and normative size into a simplified concept of state size. And I think that it's very useful to differentiate between these elements because some of them are state-level variables, some of them are systemic-level variables, some of them are material, and some of them are normative in the sense that it is connected to intangible circumstances. So that is why we have to differentiate between these 4 types of size. The second observation is that the investigation of size and the analysis of size shouldn't be only a state-level phenomenon. We should start on the state level, on the systemic level, because it is the international system, let that be the regional or the global one, which affects how smallness should be interpreted and how smallness affects the status of states in the international system. The third observation is that size, let that be smallness or largeness, is in itself meaningless. So we cannot really just use the argument that a state is small and that is why it acts in a specific way. We have to connect size to other variables because state size works in interaction with other variables. So for example, in the book, I describe how smallness in connection with other economic variables such as oil production affects not just the well-being of small states, but also their foreign policy leverage. Or the climatic environment also affects how we should take into consideration the effects of territorial size, for example. And I think that this is very important. This is a very important point because this is what makes us or should make us think that size is not a master variable which dominates every other variable or attribute of a state. For example, in the case of smaller Gulf states, we can see that the leadership of these states many times prefer coherence and political homogeneity over largeness or over growth. And I think that that's a very important outcome of the research. So these are the 3 observations which should, I think, dominate how we see smallness and its effects. And this is these 3 observations were the basis of the structure of the book. The first chapter focuses on the first aspect. The second and the third chapters focus on the systemic level variables. And the fourth chapter focuses on the interaction of state size and other variables on the state level. And I mentioned that there is a +1 observation regarding how state behavior is shaped by size. This is what the case studies are for in the 5th and the 6th chapter of the book. I argue that there are usually 3 ways in which state behavior is shaped by size. One is the traditional one, which is a negative effect. So basically, smallness can constrain state behavior in many situations. For example, when it comes to an armed conflict, a traditional armed conflict, state size can be a very negative attribute of states. Secondly, there is a way in which smallness is an obstacle in policymaking, but not such a huge obstacle. And we can see that states can learn to tackle the direct consequences of smallness. So they are not very exposed to barely the effects of smallness. And this is the toolkit which I call compensatory policies. So I argue that small Gulf states implement these compensatory policies to tackle the direct consequences of smallness, and they are quite successful in this regard. The thing in which they are not very successful is tackling the consequences of these compensatory policies. And in this way, they are just basically transform one problem into another problem. One example can be that in order to tackle demographic smallness, small Gulf states invited migrant workers to support their economy, and they can manage the negative consequences of smallness in this way. But the indirect consequences of these policies are more problematic for them when it comes to building an identity, when it comes to having this feeling of of being a minority in your own homeland. So there are many negative consequences of these compensatory policies, but these are not directly connected to being absolutely small. And the third way in which state behavior is shaped by size is can be a positive way as well. We can see that, for example, Qatar manages to use small size in nation branding. And this was especially useful when it comes to the Gulf Rift recently, in which Qatar managed to use its size, its small state, as a way in which it was able to transform this rift, this debate between its neighbors, basically a soft power debate regarding images and regarding branding activities of both sides. So when it comes to nation branding and when it comes to framing specific conflicts, I think that smallness can be quite positive and quite an advantage. I stop here, and I think that we can go into details in other questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Máté, for this very detailed explanation. Now I think to Luciano and Laszlo. So you two are renowned researchers and experts of the field of Gulf states. What do you think about using small state theory and the small state conceptual framework to the Gulf states? Do you think that it was a timely thing to carry out such a research? Did it consider a gap in the literature using these specific small state theories on Gulf states?
I don't know if you, as the former supervisor of Máté, I think you have the privilege to start.
Please, Luciano, go ahead first.
Okay. I mean, honestly speaking, I think what Máté was able to do in this book, I think is a very comprehensive approach to foreign policy of a specific group of states, but using a very elaborated theoretical framework that really can help to be used in other contexts. I think that the importance of this book is that if you separate the Gulf states from the theoretical framework is still valid to analyze, for instance, Singapore. I'm thinking about other small states that they can be analyzed through this lens. So I think that is a very appropriate way to understand. I mean, we read, I mean, even in the book are cited many works about the foreign policy of Gulf states. But I think the way Máté explained very well, combining the different variables, that they are making the smallest not the most important variable, but adding other elements that can contribute to understand, apart from personalities, apart from characteristics that had to do with the political regime itself, how countries like the Gulf states, but other states as well, in context, regional context in which they may suffer from insecurities or threat coming from bigger neighbors, whoever can survive can develop an important foreign policy, can have different roles as mediators, as facilitators, or even as countries that they actually perform a foreign policy that has impact, that have impact on other states as well, that this all theoretical framework can be very useful to use for other states. And also it provides you the justification that sometimes we hear a lot here in the region, in the Middle East, when we are applying theories coming from outside, from the Western countries or from international relational theory, that because of the specificities of these areas, this area, or the characteristics of the society, of the political regimes, IR theories cannot be used, or they are not 100% accurate to understand what is going on here. I think Mate was successful in understanding what is going on here, trying to create his own way to understand it, using IR theories, traditional ones, I mean, the traditional tools that we all use to understand this issue, understanding the specificity by adding those variables that he mentioned in the book and in the explanation as well. So undoubtedly, I will try to incorporate some of the book chapters in my courses, mainly when, I mean, I also discussed this in a couple of presentations I made about how the Arab Spring contributed to the resiliency of the Gulf states and how the reorientation of foreign policy, mainly from Emirates, Qatar, and Saudi, that is not a small state according to the definition that you use here, reoriented their foreign policy in order to guarantee the resiliency by exporting some kind of foreign policy that was sustained due to the characteristics of this political regime. So I think it's very appropriate to incorporate some of the theoretical and empirical materials that Mate has been working and presenting in this book in the courses that I am teaching, because I think it will be very useful for students from the region to understand how the GCC states and mainly some small states are perceived from abroad, and they are understood using international relation theories without any problem, without any I would say any flaw. This is basically the main idea I wanted to express on this, and of course, congratulating Mate. You mentioned that this was your thesis, but I see that in the book you went until even the Abraham Accords, so you incorporated very last-minute events that help you to understand also how this state, mainly Emirates, Bahrain, and Oman, they were dealing with that. It's a pity that what happened in Afghanistan lately, you couldn't add it, because, I mean, and this maybe will be a question later for you in the debate, how you understand what Qatar is doing in the Afghanistan scenario, or because we can discuss what I see from here, how Qataris are dealing with this issue, and, or how they are portraying the importance of Qatar at the regional international level by explaining the role in Afghanistan. But I think it would be a perfect case that you can use this to understand.
Thank you, Siano. This is indeed an interesting question. So after Laszlo, I think that we can go on with that interesting one, because I think that our audience is also very interested in that question. So Laszlo, how was it to work with Mati on his thesis?
Thanks for the opportunity. And of course, my first sentence is congratulations, and on behalf of the Department of International Relations at the university, we are very proud of you. I think it's a very timely contribution, not only to general Middle East studies, but IR theory at the same time. We have been working together since a very long time, since his bachelor studies at the university, which means more than 10 years, as far as I trying to find out the exact year when you joined to the bachelor studies. So it's a long way, and it's a huge, very positive development of Mate's professional skills. And we are very proud that he just came back from the United States recently. I think it's a very good example for other colleagues to follow, which is very important. Well, regarding the book, I completely agree with what Luciano mentioned, that it's a very timely contribution. And just think about the huge gap, existing gap between IR theories and Middle East studies previously. And just I started to wonder about the post-Arab Spring period, when from a theoretical point of view, it's mainly comparative politics, a very important theoretical part of the story, which was involved in a lot of debates. However, regarding IR theory, we see that it's missing to explain a lot of things in the region. And as area study specialists, we used to say, because the region has its own peculiarities, so it's not possible to impose or to use any theories on the region. And it's not only a Middle Eastern phenomenon, but it's a larger debate between IR general theorist or generalist and area study specialist, because we can use this example on China, on African states, and many other regions as well. But we always say that the Middle East is an exceptional place because of a lot of specialties. Well, just you may think about the neorealist even suggesting that let's keep and let's neglect small states from the analysis, and let's focus mainly on the so-called new Cold War, the Saudi-Iranian competition, and even not to discuss what's going on in the small states of the region, because according to neorealist theory, they even suggest that it's not going to explain any political processes in the region. So despite this gap between IR theory and small state studies and Middle Eastern studies, I have to say that Mate's book was very successful in somehow filling this gap with a very timely analysis on the complexity of a small state, and which is not only applying on the Gulf states, but on page 52, I just opened page 52, where you can see the complex small states of the region: Tunisia, Bahrain, Jordan, Kuwait, Lebanon, Qatar, Oman included state-like entities like the Palestinian Authority. So it's even quite interesting, which the book is of course not about North Africa, but it would be very interesting even to discuss the Maghrebi phenomenon as well. And I'm much specialized in Jordan, and I'm just wondering when I'm preparing articles on Jordan, and I never use this approach of small state studies, which really I think very important. And just a few years ago, I've been to Australia. I had the opportunity to attend an international conference on diplomacy, and I learned from there the importance of small island diplomacy, because near Australia we find small islands. Small islands, small states diplomacy, I think very important, and especially maybe we're going to speak about that, but we can apply this theory on Hungary and the V4 countries too, which is I think the utmost importance of this book in our region, because this is not just about the Middle East, and I think it's a very timely contribution in order to better understand Hungary's role, not only in the European Union, but its relation with China, Russia, the whole Eastern Partnership concept, as well as its relation with other major actors. And just 1 week ago, President Sisi visited us which was the V4 Visegrad 4 Plus initiative. So I think it's a very timely contribution. And let me stop here, and we can discuss later other parts, chapters of the book. Thank you, and we are really very proud of you.
Okay, in the meantime, I'd like to remind the audience that you can ask questions in the chat box. So if you have one, feel free to send us the questions. Before we go to the Afghanistan question, it's just one quick thing that it is important to touch upon. So all of you have mentioned that there is a huge gap between Middle Eastern studies and IR theories in general. So why is there such a huge gap between theoretical and empirical studies which concern this region? Why is there such a gap? I don't know who would like to start. I know it's a hard question.
Let me start. No, I remember one of our former colleagues at the department described the Middle East as the cemetery of the IR theories, because you can try to apply realist school, liberal school, constructivist school. However, you cannot explain what's going on in the region. Most of the scholars, I think, approach the region from a security perspective, what we see, which is of course because of the fact that from the EU perspective or the US perspective, Middle Eastern, long-lasting Middle Eastern conflicts pose a kind of threat. So that's why the security threat perception is a very important phenomenon. However, you cannot find many comprehensive IR theories application on the region. I mentioned recently the neorealist school, which trying to mainly focus on this new Cold War issue, Iran-Saudi competition. However, others suggest that in the Middle East you not find long-lasting alliances, but rather liquid alliances instead. Applying the theory is not that easy. And even just think about the Arab Spring. It started in 2011, and the second wave came 2019. Or just think about the 9/11 terror attacks. There were many scholarly articles on the failure of Middle East studies. So it's not only about the theoretical approach, which is a failure, but sometimes we see a huge debate on how area studies specialists can contribute to understand what's going in the region. And one example is, of course, this Arab Spring and the theory of exceptionalism, because before the Arab Spring, it was regarded by scholars as an exceptional theories where even political theories you cannot apply. I mean, transition models and political and economic liberalization process. But I think then that's why it's a very timely contribution, because we see this gap, and small state studies and the theory can offer something to better understand the role of countries which are usually very much neglected. And just give you one example. Yesterday I had a PhD lecture with freshman PhD students on the Middle East, and I just talk about power relations in the region, external actors, regional swing states, and major players, even non-state actors, because now it's very famous to speak about the non-state actors' role in the region. However, we completely miss a number of states in the region, like the small Gulf states. And that's why I'm saying that it's an important contribution. Thanks.
Okay, what's your take on this question, Matti and Luciano? Do you agree with Laszlo?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, of course, there are many things written about the foreign policy of these countries in the region, but I don't think it's the way that Matti approached them. I think that, I mean, since the 80s and 90s, there have been a lot of things written about foreign policy in the Middle East countries or Muslim countries or Arab countries, but they were focusing on one specific variable, Arabness, personalities of the governance, Islam, etc., etc. But the way that the Matt is doing it, I think, is a very interesting interesting way to combine the different variables, including smallness, and it's not oversimplifying things by saying, okay, it's only money. Money defines also everything. And I think this is the other point, that most of the times when we hear things on foreign policy on the Gulf states, they refer about only money. Okay, oil resources, so Saudi, Qatar and Emirates can do whatever they want. I don't think it has been the case. I mean, as Matt is also explaining in his book, there are many variables that they are involved to define the foreign policy of all the states. Of course, the fact that there are some personalities in power, realism and neorealism were unable to explain how the black box was working inside, because also it's, in terms of conducting research, sometimes very complicated to reach out with people that is in charge of decision, foreign policy making in the region. So I think that this is interesting from Matt's side, that he's approaching this group of countries without entering into that debate about the difficult way to understand institutionalized foreign policy making processes that are much more transparent in other countries, because you have a mechanisms of decision that can at least produce some evidence, some documents, some feedback. Here, you cannot do that. You need to analyze the output, and Matt is analyzing the outputs in different levels and analyzing through different variables. So I think that this is the main contribution to the field. That I said, I mean, and also sometimes here we have this idea, as I mentioned before, exceptionalism, without understanding the idiosyncrasy of this country. Sometimes they claim, I mean, many people claim that we cannot understand what is going on, what has to do with tribal politics, what has to do with religious or ethnic characteristics of these societies. And I think they can be understood. Of course, you focus more on the aspects that you can analyze, but I think Mate did very well in his book. Maybe we can discuss personally once we are together other things that maybe publicly I don't want to, because I'm still in the region. But I think we had many conversations before. Mate has been here in the region many times. I had a chance to be in Budapest as well. So I mean, we know that Mate is someone who has been doing extensive research in the region. That's why I give all the credit to this book. But I agree, of course, that there are gaps in the literature, and I think there will be still gaps in the literature. And that's why it's important to continue with this kind of production, specifically either from inside the region or from outside the region, that are approaching Gulf states from a very elaborated theoretical perspective. But again, many things were written lately, and Matt has been quoting many of them. But sometimes without this deep theoretical understanding of this, that can help to export or to extrapolate this theoretical framework to another states. And I think this is the main contribution to the area.
Matti, would you like to react on this?
Yeah, very quickly, I just want to add two or three aspects to this question. But I agree that it's much easier to rely on simply by discussions and just saying that everything is about oil, but everything is about, I don't know, Sunni and Shia division and so on. And that's one reason, I think, behind this gap. Another reason is, I think that, you know, it shouldn't be surprising that theories which are made to, you know, interpret the foreign policy of Western great powers are not applicable on non-Western, non-great powers. So I think that IR theory, if you look at it from a social or social, the perspective of socialization and the social socialization of academia, we can see that most of these theories are were developed in great powers, and they were meant to discuss American foreign policy. They were meant to discuss British or French foreign policy, and so on. So if we get away from this traditional circle of big Western powers, I think it's not surprising that these theories are not directly applicable. And I think that there is nothing exceptional in the Middle East from this perspective, because we can feel the same, I think, in Central Europe as well. We don't have to get away from the West so much, only a couple of, you know, hundreds of kilometers, that we can feel that the traditional theories don't apply directly. But there's nothing wrong with that. I think that it just takes some intellectual work to move beyond our comfort zone and take a step back and reflect on the theories and why these theories are still very much westernized. And I just would like to make one last comment regarding this gap. I think it's very important what Laszlo mentioned regarding the security aspect. Due to these constant security crises in the region, I think that we can see a huge, maybe not dominance, but a huge role in think tank research when it comes to the Middle East. And naturally, think tank research doesn't really like to include heavy theories in explaining everyday phenomena. So I think that that could be one other reason why there is this gap.
In the meantime, we received a question. So I'm going to read it, and all of you can think of your answers. So in accordance with your theory of small state interactions, how do you see the recent and currently evolving attitudes of Gulf states, especially Kuwait and Bahrain, to Iran, as well as to the silent confrontation between Iran and Saudi Arabia? So what new alliances will these states develop as their reaction to the changing security environment in their closer proximity? Lot of questions.
Yeah, I don't know how much time we have to answer this question, but naturally this is a very interesting one, and I think that there are at least two or three case studies in the book which are connected to this question. First of all, I think that the Gulf states' reaction or alignment to this Saudi Iranian rivalry and the alignment with Saudi Arabia and to a lesser extent Iran, really depends on the traditional considerations of regime stability. And naturally in this regard, we can see a very different situation when it comes to Bahrain, to Kuwait, but all other small Gulf states. Basically, the threat of Iran is, I would say, the gravest for Bahrain, which not just because of the geopolitical position being very close to Iran, but also because of its social structure, having a majority of Shia people in the society, but also the very close social connections between the Bahraini society and the Iranian society. And actually, due to these reasons, Iran claimed Bahrain as its own territory many times in history. And I think that what makes this threat the gravest for Bahrain is that Iran poses both a traditional security threat from the international sphere, but also through its interventions in Bahraini domestic politics, it's also a domestic threat, but it also contributes to domestic threats. And this is this duality which is very difficult to manage from Bahrain perspective. I think there was one case study in the book in which I tried to explain why I think it was a bad decision back in the 80s that some Gulf states made regarding managing the Iranian threat as not necessarily a domestic political threat, but focusing on the international sphere. And I think that in this regard, they damage their social coherence to a great extent, and I think that we can see the effects of that until today. So I think that from this perspective, Bahrain is in a really bad situation. When it comes to Kuwait, the regime made the decision to advocate for a passive role, I would say, in the region. Naturally, there are many instances. for example, the Gulf Rift, in which the Kuwaiti leadership tries to picture itself as a mediator. But I think that in practice, this doesn't work, especially if we compare this mediator role to that of Qatar or that of Oman, which are much more successful in this regard. So I think that all of these states have their own regime stability and regime security considerations, which connect domestic politics and international politics. And this is how we can explain their reaction to both Saudi and Iranian behavior.
Thank you, Matti. Laszlo and Luciano, do you agree with Matti? You are muted.
Sorry about that. I couldn't find the button. I agree. I mean, I have nothing to his interpretation about that.
Laszlo?
I agree too, of course. I'm just wondering to speak a bit about the potential of Iranian nuclear talks, as we see some news in the newspapers that the Vienna talks maybe coming to restart. And it's very interesting that how small Gulf states' behavior is going to be in the light of potential new nuclear talks. But I think, this is my opinion, what happened in Afghanistan is going to have an impact on the Biden administration position on the nuclear talks, which means that the US would be more cautious with Iran and the Iranian nuclear deal. So I think this is the most interesting topic for the whole Gulf region in the upcoming 2-3 months. Thanks.
In the meantime,
say something. I think that the conversations between Saudi and Iran that they are, that they started a long time ago, but they were secret and now they became officialized. I think that this is a good indicator that can help other countries, like for instance Kuwait and Bahrain, following the question, can ease their own way of approaching the big states, the big brothers in the region. I mean, as Mate mentioned in his book as well, other countries like Kuwait and Bahrain, they have no the same tools to secure their borders, or to make sure that the regimes are resilient enough. I mean, both had experiences of really serious threat to the survival, even to the state survival. So I assume that the changes in their foreign policy had to do with the reduction of this tension that can help them other tools to survive. I mean, there was never a discussion regarding Oman, Emirates, or Qatar regarding their territorial survival. Let's say in this way. Even though at the beginning of the blockade there were some rumors that Saudi could have invaded Qatar, but I mean, this was not a very serious threat. But the other two cases, of course, the situation is much more dangerous. And I think that this justified the way that Mate is analyzing other countries. I mean, in terms of how to define the small states and their capacity to defend themselves and their capacity to be resilient against external and internal threat as well. And both Kuwait and Bahrain suffer from this compared with the other countries. So I think at least it's a good news that Saudi and Iran are officializing these negotiations, because even though it did not affect specifically Qatar, Oman, and Emirates, because they had their own way to deal with both Saudi and Iran in a different way, Kuwait and Bahrain were the most vulnerable ones. Any reduction in the tension between the two countries is a good news.
Thank you for your answers. We received a question in connection with Qatar. So I think we should focus on Qatar right now, because first of all, it was one of your main case studies, Matti, as far as I remember. So you wrote about nation building in Qatar and how smallness was part of the Qatari identity and the foreign policy thinking. So in the meantime, we had an election recently in Qatar, as far as I know. So I think let's connect a couple of questions in here. So we received a question regarding small states management for the Qatari boycott. How did these small Gulf states handle it? So if you could touch upon this question and say a few words about what to expect after the elections, maybe, that would be great.
Sorry, the question is aimed at me or?
To everyone, basically.
Yeah, I would like to start with the boycott on Qatar, and maybe I think I pass the ball to Luciano when it comes to the elections taking place in Qatar. I just listened to him in a discussion. It was really interesting. So basically, the Qatari crisis, or the Gulf Rift, in which Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, the United Arab Emirates, and Egypt announced that they withdrew their ambassadors and they basically tried to isolate Qatar, was the nightmare scenario for every small state. We have Qatar, which is a very small peninsula. It has only one direct border on the mainland, which is Saudi Arabia. They basically not just tried to isolate Qatar, but according to the news coming out since 2017, there were also plans to invade Qatar. I'm not sure whether these were put on hold because of American pressure or whether they existed at all as a serious plan, but according to these rumors or this news, there was a serious consideration. This could have been very bad for Qatar, and it would have questioned its survival to a great extent. And I think that avoiding such a scenario was always in the mind of Qatari decision makers, at least in the last two decades. I don't mean specifically this scenario, but any scenarios which involve the pressure of either Saudi Arabia or Iran or a great power to basically invade the country. This is the biggest nightmare for small states. And I think that what they did is that they created an environment in which they could transform this hard power conflict, this hard power competition, into a soft power competition. After the invasion scenario was off the table, they realized that they can win this argument if they care about the perception of the international society, the members of the international society. And basically, Qatar managed to create a discourse in which the most players in the international sphere, they argued that they don't want to get involved, so they become neutral in this conflict. And in practice, being neutral in the conflict meant a pro-Qatari viewpoint, I think, because the Saudis expected, and the Saudis and the Emirates expected members of the international society to take their side. Without that element, the Saudi Emirati strategy was not able to work. So I think after a while, it was only a matter of time for the resolution. Nevertheless, the question remains whether, you know, remaining in this situation where these countries don't speak with each other could have been manageable for Saudi Arabia, for the Emirates, and so on. And we can see now that even if the rift is officially over, since in January in Al Ula, the representatives of these countries managed to get past that debate. But even in this situation, when officially now the voters of the Gulf are peaceful, even in this situation, we can see that it is only, I think, Saudi Arabia which meant this peace at all. And we can still see very, very, very serious difficulties when it comes to the Emirati-Qatar relations, Bahraini Qatar relations, and Qatari-Egyptian relations. But I think that the key thing was to transform the the hard power conflict into a soft power one. And this is how Qatar managed to succeed in this crisis.
Thank you, Mati. Then I pass the floor to Luciano to talk about the elections there a bit.
Okay. Well, I don't know exactly what you want me to tell about the elections. I have been conducting extensive research about that. I can talk for hours, but this is not the place to do it. I think in terms of foreign policy, one of the things that can be said about the election that is the timing of this election. I mean, as you all know, that elections were supposedly included in the constitution approved in 2003, but they were postponed until now, and they have been postponed in many occasions by different reasons. The last one being the blockade. And they were announced last November before the blockade ended and before even the victory of Joe Biden. So it's difficult to understand why the decision was taken when it was postponed due to the blockade and when there was no pressure from the Trump administration about conducting election or implementing elections in the country. So this is something that we are still trying to understand with scholars and other people that I am doing interviews here. And also when they decided to do this election 1 year before the World Cup. And why I'm saying that it's curious, the timing, is because the attention that is attracting the election is not as positive as the government expected. Mainly because two main reasons, because of the controversy that was created before the election because of the eligibility of some Qataris to vote that brought to the streets a small group, but it was visible. And everybody in the rest of the world focused on that for the first time there was a group of Qatari citizens protesting about something, which is something unique since the 50s. And secondly, the result of the election that showed that 30 men and no women were elected. So these are the two main aspects that they were reproduced by the international press. So even though some people claim that these elections were done in order to please the international community, to please Joe Biden, or to show, to demonstrate that Qatar is moving forward, which is actually, it's a step, it's an important step in incorporation of citizens in the decision-making process, the outcomes, at least the advertisement that is shown to the rest of the world, is not as positive as Qatar could have expected. And this is one of the main things. The other thing is that, of course, it's a positive step. It's incorporation of most of the Qataris. I wouldn't say all, because many were left aside because of the citizenship law, the electoral law, and the constitution itself that is defining who can vote or who cannot. But it's a step forward in the right direction, incorporating people to the decision making, incorporating a new institution, elected institution, replacing the appointed one that can perform in legislation, in controlling the budget, and controlling the foreign the policy of the states. This is part of Mate thesis as well. I mean, I don't think the Shura Council will have any attribution in determining foreign policy. So this will still be a reserved domain for the executive. So the role of the Shura Council in determining, defining, or criticizing the foreign policy will be, I would say, meaningless.
Yeah, if I can just add one thing to this, I think that this election is a great case study when it comes to the preference of Gulf states and governments in the Gulf of social coherence over demographic growth. So in this case, and when it comes to citizenship laws as well, they could enlarge the political community, maybe with one or two tribes or a small segment, but still they could prioritize growth compared to social coherence. But I think that what they did is they put the emphasis on social coherence.
Laszlo, would you like to comment on what has been
just one sentence about what Matej said was very important about the blockade and the Gulf Rift, and just wondering that this the experience of Qatar with the blockade has a theoretical importance as well. Just preparing an article on sanctions on the Middle East and focusing on the Iranian situation. And from the history of Middle Eastern sanctions, we saw that when the international community acts together, like in the case of Libya during the 1990s, we can say blockade, any type of blockade is more successful than is if there is any divergent voices within the global actors. And in the case of the blockade of Qatar, it was of course a regional and not a multi, I mean, it was not a global blockade, but that's why Qatari policy was, I mean, successful in that way, because not external global players not joined and not taken side with any players, which is, I think, very important phenomenon from a theoretical perspective as well.
Thank you. Now I think we are slowly running out of time. So maybe one last question I'd like to ask from all of you, if we don't have more questions coming from the audience. So at the beginning, Luciano, you mentioned that it would be an interesting case to analyze with a small state framework the role of Qatar in the Afghanistan crisis. So can you tell us a few words about that, how that could look like, and why it would be important to add maybe this as a case study, and what a future directions can be drawn in connection with the Middle East and applying small state studies and the small state analytical framework to this region. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for the hot potato. I actually wanted to send it to Mate, but anyway, I think what is interesting is that the Qatari government and the officials are actually showing muscle. Or at least this is what the official position is, how important has been Qatar contribution to solve the crisis, or at least to ease the situation of the people that wanted to leave the country in this very critical period of foreigners living in Afghanistan and dual citizens, and some people that they collaborated with the United States or international organization or other governments. And on the other hand, Qatari contribution to the dialogue that the United States started to have with the Taliban here several years ago, and the continuation of this dialogue that has been conducted here between the acting government in Afghanistan with Americans, with Europeans, and with other countries, or anybody that want to talk to the Taliban, and they don't want to go to Afghanistan, of course. So I think that this is interesting to show that from the small state theory, how a country was able to facilitate all these elements, and on the other hand, still keeps some kind of leverage, or at least this is what the Qatari government expect, to have some leverage on the future definition of the government in Afghanistan and some of the policies that the Afghan government would implement internally and even externally, which is, I think, the most important thing. I mean, from the way I understand what is going on with the Afghanistan case, is as far as Afghanistan is not creating problems in the neighborhood, an already unstable neighborhood, most of the governments will be okay. The only way to guarantee that is preventing Afghanistan to export instability, to export terrorism, to export to prevent the exporting any negative element that exists within the new political regime. And the countries that they will be able to do that will not be the United States, will not be the European Unions. They will be the countries that either are surrounding them, Pakistan, Iran, Turkey, Qatar, Emirates, and Saudi, that they are the countries that they can perform some kind of leverage. I think it's interesting to understand how from the small state theory, both Emirates and Qatar can play that role, because we know that Turkey, Iran, are countries that they cannot be considered small, and they have their own relation with Afghanistan, Pakistan as well, and their long history and even borders. So how the small state theory can help us understand both the role of Qatar and Emirates.
Let's go on with Laszlo, and then Marty will have the final say.
I have a very interesting remark to mention because I just returned from Pakistan 2 weeks ago, and I extensively made research on newspapers on Afghanistan-related issue. And I realized that not many times Qatar name mentioned in the Pakistani media. Of course, there is a kind of competition who owns the Taliban issue, or who is going to solve, if it is possible to solve, the Afghan case. And of course, according to the Pakistanis narrative, it's mainly Pakistan is the key player. However, the weakness of Pakistan, I think, lies in the absence of financial resources. And here, I think Qatar can come in. But when we are discussing the cultural and historical ties, of course, Qatar is a bit far from the region. And I saw some similarity as well, the behavior and foreign policy of Qatar regarding the moderate Islamist movement in the region during the Arab Spring. And this is quite similar what's going on in the case of Afghanistan, which is of course not the same issue, but we see here a moderating movement with political integration. However, the Qataris approach with those Muslim Brotherhood related organization, we know that it's, I mean, a kind of failure, especially because of the mismanagement of the countries and of course Saudi's interference in the case of Egypt. So I'm just wondering, applying this Muslim Brotherhood related story to the Afghan situation, what would be the outcome of the Afghan story? This is from the Qatari perspective. Thanks.
And Marty?
I think that if we apply traditional theory or traditional thinking to this situation, we could talk endlessly about the threats coming from Afghanistan, or the threats which could come from Afghanistan and which would in the Middle East or for small states. And that's perfectly fine. So I think that that's an important topic. On the other hand, I think that if we apply a more comprehensive approach, we can see why the Afghan crisis represented an opportunity for many smaller Gulf states. So just think about the Emirates, which use the Afghanistani portfolio as a way in which they can brand themselves more as a little Sparta, as they are usually called in American circles. So they say they try to use this situation to contribute to some missions and so on, and in which they can prove a way in which they can prove their added value to military campaigns and multilateral military actions. On the other hand, I think that Qatar is also trying to prove its added value to multilateral cooperation, but not in a military way, but in other ways, mainly two ways, I think. The first is that they, through this hedging strategy in which they are in good terms with both the United States, with the Taliban and other actors, other important actors such as Iran, Pakistan, and Turkey as well, they can be a valuable connecting point between these actors. And we can see that the American administrations, regardless of them being a Democrat or Republican, they use Qatar in talking with the Taliban or managing the Afghanistan portfolio. And the second thing is that when it comes to this very, let's say, interesting way in which the Americans pulled out of Afghanistan, this also was problematic for many actors, but this was also an opportunity for Qatar to show that they are valuable when it comes to a logistical hub, being a logistical hub in the region. And this is why Qatar was very willing to help in getting refugees or people out of Afghanistan, who helped either the Americans or one of the allied nations in Afghanistan. So I think that there are many opportunities to take, and that goes back and that brings us to the discussions on nation branding, on how Qatar used these opportunities to enlarge their importance in the international sphere, so enlarging their normative size, if you will. And you know, since I haven't shown the book so far in the discussion, let me show the cover of the book, which is really nice. I think this is not what I, so this is not my product that we just had to choose between different ideas and different designs. The reason why I showed the cover is that actually there is an idea behind that. So a typical small state discussion would discuss or would interpret small state foreign policy as being highly limited, both in terms of territory or of geographic space and in terms of available tools in foreign policy. But I think that what this cover shows is a more confusing or more confusing and more innovative picture, which shows us that a small state foreign policy is not constrained both, neither in from a spatial perspective. So Qatari foreign policy can affect Afghanistan, can affect even questions and crises which are very far away from their borders, but also in terms of policy decisions, they can be innovative and they can many times they actually have a wider toolkit when it comes to a specific situation.
Thank you very much, Máté, for this lovely end show with the book. If Laszlo and Luciano, you don't have any comments on what Máté just said, and if we don't have further questions from the audience, then I'd like to wrap up this session. Thank you very much, Luciano and Laszlo, for being here, and Máté as well for writing the book and organizing this event. And of course, I'd like to thank our audience for the great questions that we received. I hope you enjoy this very lovely event. Sure, we could talk about hours this book. I'm sure that we can fill even a course at university with what was written in the whole book. So thank you very much for everyone, and I wish you a lovely day.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and congratulations again, Matt.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing.
We want to see the second volume.
All right. Hopefully, inshallah.
Bye.
Goodbye. Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.